back to the Comics Alliance podcast, covering the latest comic book entertainment news topics. I'm Andy Khouri, senior editor of ComicsAlliance.com, the comic book blog of comics culture, news, humor, and commentary. With me, as always, is Comics Alliance senior editor Caleb Goellner, author of Mermaid Evolution and the writer of Task Force Rad Squad. Joining us today is Comics Alliance contributor Matt D. Wilson, writer of such comics as Copernicus Jones, Robot Detective, and other books like The Supervillain Handbook and The Supervillain Field Manual. Today we're going to talk about the week in comic book news, specifically the keynote address delivered by Image Comics publisher Eric Stephenson to the Comics Pro Retailer Conference in Atlanta. Stephenson made a characteristically iconoclastic and not altogether unassailable presentation, urging retailers to become community leaders, abandon their support of dubious publishing practices, and draw a distinction between good and bad comics. We'll contrast Stephenson's remarks with those of Dan DiDio, his counterpart at DC Comics, one of the top superhero publishers, who in an interview this week confirmed plans to double or even triple down on publishing strategies that are seemingly exactly the sort of thing Stephenson criticized. For those of you listening who don't know, Comics Pro is a kind of trade organization in the comic book business for retailers specifically, and they sort of gather and attend symposia and things like that to talk about ways to advocate for their business. It's kind of a convention for retailers. And Stephenson made some remarks that got a lot of people talking this week. Matt Wilson wrote about this for Comics Alliance. Matt, what were some of your takeaways from Eric Stephenson's speech?
I think the main takeaway that I got from it was this idea that, you know, his point that the gimmicky stuff, which would be, for example, 3D covers, or any kind of weird special covers, renumbering, reprints of old series, and then extremely high price points are simply not sustainable business and are, kind of short-term ways to manage the bottom line, but are not, a way to keep comics kind of sustainably going. And he took that point to flow into, you know, those are clearly things that Marvel and DC does. And to be perfectly honest, Image is certainly on the variant covers train and has been for some time, and has reprinted Walking Dead, I don't know, number one, I don't know how many times. So in some ways he was kind of, you know, giving himself a little bit of a lecture there. But, he used that to parlay into this idea that Marvel and DC superheroes aren't the only comics that are out there. And people have largely made up their minds about those characters, like whether they want to read more stories or hear more stories or see more stories with them in them. So what is going to make comics grow is going to be new characters and new genres and new ideas. I actually saw some Marvel editors kind of getting upset about that on Twitter, as if to say, basically saying, Eric Stephenson is saying that our comics aren't valid comics, and that's unfair to us. But it certainly, you know, what he had to say certainly created some waves. I think for a lot of reasons, like the types of stories that comics can tell or should be telling, and then just the business, like what works in the business and what will continue to work.
I suppose it is worth pointing out that if you look at the list of things Stephenson talk about and you just draw a red line through everything he thinks is not working at comics, you're sort of left inescapably with Image Comics, you know?
Although like I said, it's not all, like, that's not all stuff that Image Comics doesn't do. Like, Image has superhero books. It has Invincible has been around for however many issues, more than 100. He's not entirely singling out Image as like the shining light on the hill that I think he wants to make it out to be.
Well, he can't.
I think he may be inadvertently kind of criticized himself, or at least his company, his own company, in some ways.
Caleb Goellner, what do you think?
Man, this speech, I was really busy on Friday, so I read a little bit of the commentary before I allowed myself to read the whole speech because I was afraid of how much I would react. And so I actually read it this morning before we started recording, and I had like this horrible knee-jerk reaction to much of what he said, which was, okay, I've thought about all these things too. I have a lot of different perspectives in like the comics industry and world, and even like some of the creation aspect. And this isn't the first time Stephenson's done this kind of conversation. You know, I think Image Expo, the past like two, he said a lot of familiar things. I think at the Eisners, he said a lot of these things. This was kind of just the latest in his ongoing narrative. What really had people talking was when he said there are good comics and bad comics. And that like is a philosophical issue. He's basically talking about, he's asking like the question, like, what is art? And like having the art versus commerce conversation. And in that regard, I think a lot of people's eyes rolled out of their head and onto the floor and into the pile of money the Image has, so to speak. Because, you know, it's like Matt said, it's like Image is basically doing everything that he criticized except for owning Spider-Man. And I kind of disagree with, like, you know, Image was founded on bad comics. Like, I think there's not good and bad comics. I think there's cool comics and lame comics, or exciting comics versus boring comics. And that's totally up to the reader.
I also think that a discussion of art at a retailer's conference is sort of strange.
Yeah, no, it's weird.
The venue is a strange choice, because what matters to a retailer isn't what's good or what's bad.
It's what sells.
It's what sells or what doesn't sell, right?
Yeah.
Well, he's trying to create, you know, a new way of thinking in the retail community that, and this sounds, you know, sort of obvious, but he's trying to say better comics will sell more comics. As I said before, it's very easy to take badly because he's the head of Image Comics and he's the one telling you we've got the answer, you know, to this scenario that I'm laying out.
Yeah. So in that regard, like I had my knee jerk, like emotional response to this kind of, I guess I would kind of almost characterize it as a sermon. I don't know. Anybody who like grew up going to church, they hear like this kind of like wisdom, you know, and right now I think Stevenson's a little bit of the wise man on the mountain, so to speak. Like, he's had all these hits. So Image has had, you know, problems in its different incarnations over the years, but Image is finally at a place where, and he admitted this, where The Walking Dead is on TV and they're winning Eisners and he's got everybody, who, by the way, is like the biggest star at Marvel, writing books for him that are good, and he's selling them. So he's really in a position to, I don't know if I would say brag, but make that claim that he does have the answer, or the Image does anyway, not he himself. So, yeah, I mean, it's all, you know, I step away from it and I just think all I can see is the strategy here. And, you know, it's working because we're talking about it. And that's the best that you can hope for, is that it gets everybody talking about Image. And Image books are at the top of the conversation in retailers. Because that translates, you know, a number of different ways into the conversation being about Image when people go to shop. You know, fans go to the store. What do you got from Image? Retailers go, oh, I see you bought Spider-Man, or you bought Hawkeye by Matt Fraction. Well, he has like a million new Image books, so here you go.
Right. That's a really interesting dimension of this that he didn't address in his remarks. Because, and I think the reason people took them some people took them badly was because the good versus bad and sort of his characterizations of the superhero area of the business creates, like I said, a versus system that's not really reality. Because as you say, Caleb, Image's most successful books, with some notable exceptions, were built from the direct market audience that the creator enjoyed at Marvel and DC. It's hard to imagine a lot of Image books existing without that background. Its whole model, well, not whole model, again, there are many exceptions, but a lot of hits exist in this model where Image becomes a home to creators who spent time in the work for hire sphere.
Or you could say built a name for themselves in the work for hire sphere.
Right. It's an ecosystem. Yeah. I don't know that one exists without the other, you know, because at the same time, like, people who get their start at creator owned publishers will jump over to, like, Jonathan Hickman, very notably, got his very first comic book was at Image, and then he went on to become a big shot at Marvel. And some other people who start out on smaller books at Marvel get really big and then go to Image and have their enormous hits. Like, it's a circle of life kind of thing, don't you think, Matt?
It's cannibalistic is what it is. It's this, you know, people get their start understandably and always. I mean, this is just how comics work. You start with a comic you make yourself, you know, and get published wherever, whether you self-publish it or you get some small press publisher to publish it, or now you can publish it online, or you might get lucky enough to get that book in front of Image and have Image put it out. And then that's how you get noticed by Marvel and DC, where you're doing work for hire, but you're making more money and you get a bigger audience. And then you parlay that bigger audience. You know, this is kind of a recent thing, but virtually every creator that makes a name for themselves is doing this thing where they find a bigger audience at Marvel and DC, and then they use that to do creator-owned stuff that's actually popular and that makes money. I mean, that's just the system that's becoming the norm.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sort of the snake eating its tail. You know, it's just that thing where you end up back where you started, but at a bigger level. And I don't know, it's very strange. Like, Stephenson makes so many kind of disparate points in his speech. Like, not only does he go after superhero comics, but he also goes after licensed comics.
Yeah, I thought that was very interesting, because Image had a lot of licensed comics. And essentially, if you think about it, I mean, like, that's what Profit is. Profit is like a Rob Liefeld property that he is putting talent to work on. You know, it's like Profit is almost as much of a licensed book, or it is as much of a licensed book as Adventure Time. You know what I mean? Like, it's not a cartoon. It doesn't exist in other multimedia.
Well, the two examples that really stuck out to me that he stated were Star Wars and Transformers. And him basically saying those kinds of comics aren't going to solve the problems of comics, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he's right on that. I also don't think that anybody that's publishing Star Wars and Transformers comics, Dark Horse, does IDW still have the Transformers license?
Yeah.
So Dark Horse, IDW, soon to be Marvel taking over Star Wars. I don't think they're trying to solve the problems of comics with those properties. I think they're trying to put something out there that people can identify, and if they really like those cartoons or movies, they can have more of it. Just like there are Star Wars novels and, you know, other Transformers things and things like that. I think he's in some ways he's trying to smush two different arguments that don't necessarily go together.
Right.
And one of those arguments I really buy, the notion that gimmicky stuff is not going to save comics. Like, the fact that Miracle Man number one was $8 is insanity. No comic, single issue of a comic should cost $8. But I don't see necessarily how that melds with this idea of, you know, superhero comics in general aren't I don't know, a viable way to move forward in comics or to grow.
The argument that licensed books are not helping comics speaks to a kind of activist tone that all his remarks took. And this was my biggest takeaway, was his direct appeals to retailers about the nature of their business. He pointed out correctly, and I didn't think about this before, that while other kinds of bookstores have disappeared, comic book retailers remain, and some of them are doing very well. And he's asking them to become essentially community leaders, more like what we might think of a nightclub owner or a DJ or promoter, not just a merchant that resells material and products that they bought wholesale. He wants workshops, he wants events, book clubs and things like that. He made an argument that I don't think I've heard anyone say, which is that the direct market is the future of comics, and not what we've been hearing for a long time, which is the bookstore market, the internet, digital. You know, all his remarks to this group of retailers was about how to get new readers into their stores and not comic books out of the store, which I think has been a prevailing discussion for a long time in comics, is about whether the direct market is a viable delivery system for comics anymore.
I think that what he's saying comes from a very narrow viewpoint that I would love to get some retailer perspective on, because his focus is entirely on books, you know, comic books, trade paperbacks, the stuff that sells that, you know, he talks about graphic novel sales growing and how a comic book retailer, a comic book shop, it has a much larger graphic novel section than Barnes & Noble does, you know? But I would love to see a breakdown of a few retailers' revenues to see how much of their revenue actually comes from books and how much of their revenue comes from other stuff.
You mean periodicals?
I mean,
like
statues,
magic cards,
toys,
yes,
games, you know, novelties, things that are not books. Because I think that one thing that has kept comic book stores viable and kept comic book stores helped them thrive is that kind of that market where it's, we're the only place where you can buy this one particular type of toy that you think is super cool, or this statue, or this replica of Thor's hammer, or whatever, that, you know, you're not going to find at in the toy aisle of Target. I mean, I don't know what the breakdown is, but I would be interested to see, you know, how much of that kind of stuff is kind of what is inspiring that growth or helping that growth for comic book stores, and how much of it actually has to do with, you know, the weekly comics they're selling or the graphic novels they're selling. Cause that, you know, that might undercut what Stephenson is saying a little bit there. I think back to his point about the whole notion of comics being hubs, like cultural hubs. I think that is a great point. I also think that the best comic book stores are already doing that, are already those things, and already have events where people, you know, can come in and meet a creator, or come in and talk about a book they like, or, you know, that people can just kind of come in and have a conversation with other people who are into comics in maybe kind of a loose setting. Not all comic book shops are doing that, and some comic book shops are really bad. But the best ones are already doing what he's kind of envisioning here.
Yeah, it's part and parcel of what he was saying about the cycle of the sort of superhero business. I think the broad point he's getting at is that everyone who's going to buy superhero comics is already buying them. The business that facilitates that is not growing. It's maintaining. And the stores that do these things that he proposes are selling more different kinds of books and more different kinds of merchandise and endearing themselves to a community. And that's a very good thing. Like he pointed out, these characters exist in the most popular movies that we make in this country. They could not have bigger penetration into the zeitgeist and has not translated to more comic book sales. Like, I think he's trying to say retailers need to get their heads out of the Marvel and DC big two or big three place, because we're at it. Like, this is the zenith of it, you know, with some exceptions like President Obama on a Spider-Man cover, you know what I mean? But again, what interests me about this is that he thinks that these other comics, let's say the extra superhero comics, are going to thrive in the direct market.
I think he's also asking retailers to have a, kind of a crystal ball here. I think he's in some ways asking retailers to do the impossible, which is suss out and determine which books, which non-superhero books are going to catch on.
Which the is one's Image does.
It's obviously the one's Image does,
Matt. Yeah. Yeah. Well, in reality, that's an impossible proposition. You know, The Walking Dead, zombies are a big deal, but there are plenty of other zombie comics that have not caught on the way The Walking Dead did. It just happened to come at a great moment for it. The Walking Dead could have just as easily been a book that did okay, and that was it. It's really hard to look in the previews catalog and see the books that are coming out and the concepts that are coming out that are not superhero related and say, okay, that's the one that I'm going to push, or that's the one that I'm going to base my comic book store book club on. I mean, you know, I'm not to say that retailers don't have some idea of just what they personally like, but to be able to predict what's going to be successful is a roll of the dice.
And also successful beyond their existing customers. That's the aim here, is to, as Stephenson said, target anyone who's not reading comics. So just the proposition of looking at previews as a way to do that.
You know, after like a few years of the iPad being on the market, everybody has finally been able to wash their hands of, like, let's call it digital guilt, which is, oh, we're hurting our retailers, which are, you know, our meal tickets. Once they got some data, or maybe, you know, some indication that things weren't being cannibalized, now they're just like, oh yeah, we have DRM-free comics. They didn't take the risk, really. I mean, some publishers did. Like, Archie did all this stuff forever ago and didn't make a big deal about it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But everybody's talking about digital now, like, oh, it's only additive, it's only additive, it's only additive. And if that's true, maybe that's where new readers who don't care about superheroes, I've heard anecdotally from some people in the business who would know that a lot of what sells in the digital space has to do with licensed comics and things that, say, let's say, people who are fans of other multimedia enjoy. So, like, gamers like comics about giant robots and, like, guys with guns killing things, you know, like first-person shooters and that kind of stuff. Those comics tend to do really well on digital. So it's just interesting. It's like, well, if you think the future is in the direct market with these new kinds of books and these new kinds of genres and, like, maybe even new creators, you know, how do you, like, one way of kind of figuring that out would be to see what's popular in digital as well. But nobody talks about what's successful in digital because the numbers aren't available. You know, Comixology is a private company and they want to keep that all to themselves so that they can continue to have this, I guess, informed conversation about how it's truly affecting the market with, major retailers and stuff.
I'm just not convinced at all that the direct market is equipped, or rather, it's so arcane, the whole periodical system, the previews system, the way that comics works for people who aren't, who didn't grow up in it, who don't deal with it every week, to come in and start becoming a weekly comic customer. You know what I mean? It's a huge barrier. And I think we'll talk about this more in another episode, but the problems that, for example, Marvel has with their trade paperbacks and, you know, the Captain America Winter Soldier, that there are four or five versions of it. Like, there's a lot of problems in the direct market. And I mean, I don't mean comic book stores. There's problems with the way that business is done in the direct market with respect to the products and how they're marketed and how they're distributed. It's very, very weird, especially once you explain it to somebody who doesn't deal with it all the time.
A lot of that comes back to there only being one distributor, who is often terrible. But
sure, but that's the way it is. You know?
Yeah.
And Stephenson seems to believe that introducing more people into this is going to be a good thing. And I think it might be a repellent to them. I would love for comic book stores to be a place where all kinds of people could go and talk about art and talk about their favorite characters and make friends. And I would love for comic books to be as rich a scene as any given music scene. But I just don't know that, you know, what John Byrne calls civilians can opt into this system as it exists. If there was a way that comic book stores could get out of the sort of diamond model and order things and return them and everything made sense and it was easy to tell someone, like, if you like this movie, you can buy this. If you like this kind of story, you can buy this. As simple as possible, then I think what Stevenson's talking about would be a lot easier to realize conceptually.
Well, there's also the question of reputation. I mean, comic book stores absolutely still have a reputation of not being welcoming to everyone. There was the huge controversy, Tumblr argument going on a couple weeks ago about the cartoon about a comic creator,
right,
going into a comic shop.
Noel Stevenson, right?
Right.
Noel, no relation.
Stevenson. Yeah.
Yeah.
No relation.
Going into a comic shop and being belittled. When she is a comic book creator, and you know, that led to arguments about all kinds of things, but there is still a stigma reputationally for comic book shops as being just not welcoming to certain customers. And one point that Stevenson makes in his speech is that one of the biggest growing segments of comic book readers is women. But I know personally, just anecdotally, lots of women who do not like going into comic shops because of the atmosphere, and also because they're often going to see art that makes them go, ugh, you know, that's going to make them feel bad.
Mm-hmm.
Because it depicts women in a not very pleasing or complimentary light. You know, it's not just, hey, let's get good books in here and then we're going to get huge audiences. There are a lot of moving parts that right. comic book shops are going to have to deal with, different things that reputationally the comic book shops are going to have to deal with before they become those welcoming places.
Right. Not just in terms of the events and community stuff, but just their whole aesthetic, their whole vibe. Especially if you do take for the sake of argument that the superhero business is as big as it's going to get in terms of publishing, does a store need to dedicate all its space, all its wall promotion, its windows to that kind of stuff? Can the store change? And this is what I thought was, you know, very kind of cool and audacious about the speech, was that he was really appealing to retailers, some retailers, to change the whole nature of their business and their store, which is their life. You know, it's very, it's a tall order on a lot of levels.
It's kind of like barging into somebody's house and being like, you're a slob, you need an extreme makeover and your life will be better. And in a lot of cases it's, you know, like we talked about, it's sort of true. So, I mean, on a lot of philosophical and idea based levels, Stevenson's speech resonated with me. in a lot of ways. And then in some other ways, you know, I won't call anything he said hypocritical because he owned up to a lot of, well, do as I say, not as I'm doing right now. Where, you know, things are changing. But yeah, it's like, there's some really good stuff, but there's so much stuff in his speech, and it's to such a particular audience that isn't necessarily operating in the way that's best for, let's say, not only the readers, but the medium itself. You know, if you want to get like really grand with his ideas. So, I mean, it's just like, he said so much so quickly to such a specific segment of the business, and it's important to say the business, not just, you know, the medium and fans and readers and stuff, that, you know, it's almost hard. He kind of gets a pass for a lot of this stuff in the speech that doesn't necessarily add up in my mind. And it'll be interesting to hear clarification down the road and more of what he says, because I think this narrative, that Image is a leader and this is why, that's the narrative that Image has been using for a couple of years now. And I think it's only going to keep being pushed further and further, until there's like some kind of climax with it. So I'm really interested to see where the Image narrative goes coming soon.
What's next?
Yeah. What's next? Eric. You got it, Andy.
All right. The other thing I wanted to talk about today was Dan DiDio and DC Comics, because they are sort of the mirror of the things that Stephenson was talking about in his speech. DiDio recently spoke with Newsarama about DC's plans for this year, which include more 3D covers, which were a big deal on a lot of levels in 2013, and no fewer than 3 weekly series. It's interesting because the 3D covers is a, you know, expensive retail gimmick. Weekly comics are a gimmick. It can be not, which doesn't preclude quality, mind you, but they are, you know, a expensive proposition for the reader. And they are the sort of things that Stephenson very specifically said was hurting comics. And then the next day, or the same day even, Dan DiDio, who's Stephenson's counterpart in a way, essentially his counterpart, comes out and says that what we're going to do to energize our brand and to bring excitement back into this business is exactly what the other guy said is hurting the business. So
I think it's weird that DC's way of energizing comics is to revisit its greatest hits, because 3D comics, 3D covers were something they did last year in September. And while they were successful, even the people who bought them, I think, thought they were very gimmicky. And then the idea of weekly comics is revisiting 52 and Countdown. You know, the 52 being a very successful weekly comic, and Countdown less so.
And Trinity. Remember that one?
Trinity's another one. The fact that it's very much just what we did before, but more of it, or doing it concurrently with several different things. Like, I don't know how many 3D covers they're planning on having, but they're going to have 3 weekly series going all at once.
Right. That's Batman Eternal, a weekly Batman events. A story called The New 52 Futures End, and an unnamed third weekly series, all running concurrently. Not necessarily 3 number ones every week, 3 number twos every week, but there'll be some overlap with the production.
Right. The Batman series is going to start in April. Futures End is going to start in May. And then the third series is going to start in October. And they have confirmed that those three will run concurrently, at least for a while. And, you know, it's hard enough to keep one weekly series going. 52 drove Steve Wacker away from DC, basically.
Is that really how it works? I don't know. I don't know about that. I know he got another job during that
He got another job during that time.
I don't know if it drove him away as such.
Well, I'm sure managing a weekly comic is not a thing an editor really likes to do.
I mean, he went over to Marvel and did three weeks of Spider-Man in a row.
He did basically the same thing at Marvel. So maybe it wasn't the schedule that drove him away. But 52 was a weird, fluid kind of event as it was happening. To the point where it ended in a very different place than where it began. And, you know, weekly comics are they're a big proposition, especially when we're in an environment in comics right now where, one of the top complaints that I hear from people is that comics, this concept of double shipping comics is not only problematic, but kind of making it harder for people to keep up with things. Marvel's and also leading to inconsistent art. And I think people tend to appreciate consistency in their art, even if that means that a comic isn't monthly. If it has to be bi-monthly, or bi-monthly is twice a month, but every 2 months, sometimes people would prefer that. So putting all your chips in on weekly comics, it sounds odd to me. DiDio did say one interesting thing, which is that these weekly books are actually going to serve as replacements for canceled monthly books.
Yes, that's very interesting. They, as ever, they are holding to their more or less 52 titles model. And the exact quote was that, "We are not adding more product in. It's just as the weaker books go away, we're adding the weeklies."
I love that. Go away.
Yeah. As they go
just,
away.
They stop. We don't cancel them. They just fade away, man.
It has the effect, though, of adding several more titles, doesn't it? Like at least three more a month, right? Because just because a book comes out weekly doesn't mean it costs any less.
Right. Yeah.
But they're all going to be Batman books or Superman books or whatever the existing line is, so it's funny. It's like, I don't know, everything he said in this interview just kind of, and I'll just be honest, basically everything Dan DiDio ever says kind of hits me like a cold bucket of water in the face or something. Like, it's so counter to, like we said, Stevenson's narrative of things are getting better, and it's because of creativity and original content and thinking about things kind of in this positive way that values making comics. DiDio talks about DC's comics always, almost, even if, he tries to phrase it otherwise. He talks about DC comics as a product, and I think that kind of conversation, specifically from him at DC, it syncs up with the kind of comics they're making right now. I said Eric Stephenson has a calculating personality, the way he talks about Image. I don't think the books are calculating necessarily. I think a lot of those books have a lot of heart and are a lot of the best books in comics right now. But, how much heart and how many good ideas and how much amazing art are you going to get out of, a publisher that's basically devoted to weeklies? It's like you can count the number of Batman stories you thought changed your life on your shelf on a couple hardcovers and trade paperbacks and stuff. So it everything he said in this interview just kind of, took me aback. It should stop taking me aback, because I think he's very consistent with the way he talks about things. But I know I'm babbling, but the one thing that just made me I think I laughed out loud was when he said the excitement is quieting down in superhero comics. And I didn't laugh because that was a I was judging whether or not what he's saying is true about comics. But, you know, like, how big are the comic book movies, the superhero movies right now that even DC's doing? Like, Man of Steel made a ton of money. It was a huge deal. The excitement hasn't gone anywhere. You know, the cons are full, which are, you know, a lot of superhero fans dressed up like superheroes, a lot of DC heroes. And so it's almost like when he says that these books, the excitement is quieting down, it's like, what does that mean? And, you know, my only conclusion when he says excitement's quieting down is our sales are slipping because people don't like these books as much right now.
Well, you can basically envision or imagine the DC Entertainment accountant standing over his shoulder, right?
Sort of, yeah. I mean, like,
yeah, like it's there's so much on the surface accounting in what he's saying in this interview, and like I can tell you when the excitement died down about the New 52. It was somewhere around October 2011, right?
Yeah.
October or November 2011.
2 months after it launched is what you're saying.
Yeah, yeah. Because people tried the number one issues. They decided, okay, I'm going to keep up with three or four of these. And then they bought those three or four, and that's it. And then maybe they quit those eventually. But the calculation, as you said, Caleb, of these weekly comics is very obvious. Like it's partially based on like, okay, we were successful with 52, but it's also based on, okay, we could publish an issue of the Green Team and an issue of, I can't even tell you what some of DC's lower tier books are right now. We can publish an issue of All-Star Western. We can publish an issue of
the Green Arrow,
or, you know, we could publish four different issues of different comics in a month that have these audiences that are all different audiences. Or we could publish four Batman comics that are all part of one series that will conceivably maintain an audience across those four issues.
Well, because you have to, because you're going to miss something otherwise. You know, right. Like even Marvel isn't doing that. You know, they have all these X-Men books that kind of, you know, they share continuity, but you can stick within a series if you need to, or just that's the way you want to do it. This is like removing that family of books. They're turning it into one book. And that's like, that's kind of an old school notion. What was the DC had one weekly book before they ever did 52, and was it Adventures of Superman for a while, or just no, Superman, or Action Comics?
All the Superman titles carried into each other. So the story was effectively a weekly comic, but different creative teams every week. Well, yeah, not different creative teams every week, but
it had a little bug on the cover that told you
right
what issue this particular issue was in the series of Superman.
Right.
Okay. And in fairness, Marvel did that too with the Spider-Man line during the Clone Saga and some other stuff. But that was always, in Marvel, it was always a special thing. At DC, that was kind of their attempt to make a single monthly.
Well, I think it was quite effective at the time. They had consistent creative visions. I mean, we're digressing a little bit to talk about 20-year-old Superman comics. But they had four or five titles, and there was a set creative team on each one, and they all collaborated to drive a story through, you know, from week to week to week. With one of them eventually, like, every now and then there'd be a new storyline devised by one of them in collaboration with their editors and everybody like that. It was pretty sophisticated, but the industry was a lot more robust then. There were many other options for Superman comics besides the ongoing narrative, you know what
it's,
I mean?
I mean, it's not entirely different from the model they used for 52, where you had a group of four writers, all who basically had their own stories, and then they blended them together. Mm-hmm. The way they collaborated with artists on that was different. But, that's very similar to what that was. And in some ways, it sounds like that's kind of what's happening with Batman Eternal. You've got one, you got Scott Snyder overseeing it with a team of writers sort of working under him. It's strange to me that Snyder's not being called the editor of Batman Eternal. He's just kind of like the head writer.
It's a showrunner.
It's like a TV writer's room almost.
Mm-hmm. Director.
And then you've got a team of artists working under that. I mean, I don't know how it's going to actually turn out. But it's sort of that approach, at least with that weekly book, that 52 approach. But how it all actually turn out creatively, I have no idea.
Here's another quote from DiDio that speaks to what you guys were just talking about. "We are going to have another weekly series kicking off in October that will be set in the current DCU timeline that will have direct implications on what's happening in the 5 years later storyline. And you'll see a level of connectivity that I think will help really bring into focus where we see the future of the DCU." And if you unpack all that, it's just about more and more things happening later and more and more things, you know, being so connected that you need to get in on it, to follow, to get to that payoff.
It's,
you know,
it's before Future's End is what it is.
Before Future's End.
Yeah. Yeah. It's puzzling. And like, I guess this is a kind of confusing metaphor, but like, it's like, well, we're building a puzzle here, and at the same time, we're building a puzzle there. And if you combine these two puzzles, it's one big puzzle. And I mean, it's just like, man, that's just, I think when DC did 52 and it did 1 year later at the same time, that worked for me in a way that I felt okay about buying everything. And I actually did see some parallels and I did see some good thinking. And when I read some of that stuff, I felt like they did think ahead and it was intentionally planned. And, you know, I never felt like it was this mess, you know? And I was like, okay, 1 year later is kind of neat because...
You mean creatively?
Yeah, creatively. And, you know, there's some good books that came out during that time, you know, to me at the time. You know, it was very clear from the get-go. These things are going to start at the same time. This is what this is. This is what this is. 52 is a mystery explaining the time jump. And that was all on everybody's mind because lots of things were doing time skips. Like a lot of TV series were doing it between seasons and all this stuff. So it just made a lot of sense to me. This stuff, it's like they haven't finished thinking it out before the announcement. And you can kind of tell. That's how it feels anyway. It's like, yeah, we're going to do all this stuff that we did before. It's going to be great. Trust us. And then I almost wanted Newsarama to be like, really? Are you sure? You know, like ask a follow-up, you know, like, because I would love to see what they would say to that. They'd be like, well, I'm sure, you know.
Well, at the very least, why not ask, isn't this fairly similar to 52 and 1 year later?
Well, I will
get him to respond to that.
Well, I don't know if I want to get into how they do their stuff, but I have yet to see anybody really put, and you know, that includes us, put DiDio up against the wall and be like, dude, what do you really mean? What the hell is going on? Because this is all just a quagmire to me. Like, in writing this article, and like as you wrote it, and I was reading it, and I was like, I had to like double check everything that was, you know, that he said, because it's like, what does this mean? Like, I was confused. And it seems like he was explaining it as plainly as he possibly could. But what my takeaway from it was that, like, no, this doesn't make sense. Even when you try to explain it to me in a way that does, it just doesn't make sense. And that's, like, my takeaway. I don't have confidence in these books.
Well, I'm sorry. In the same way that it's weird for me for Eric Stephenson to talk about to retailers about a quality proposition of good versus bad comics, it's similarly weird to me for Dan DiDio, who it seems would whose main concern or one of his chief concerns, at least in terms of selling a comic to the public, would be a creative one. Or at least in that case, it seems like it would be a quality issue to just say, in a very thinly veiled way, this is stuff you will buy. Because that's what it all reads as to me.
Exactly. Like creative, you know, discussion aside, do we think that the three weekly series, the 3D covers, is this going to serve their purpose? in the accounting sense, you know? Are people going to buy it? We bemoan these events and crossovers and gimmicks, but they keep doing them.
Well, in a very short term sense, they are successful. The 3D covers were successful for that 1 month. The New 52 was successful for a couple of months. The short term gains from these gimmicky things do bear out. It's the problem is that it's very clear that DC isn't thinking long term about anything.
I would like to have a retailer on to talk about the success of the Marvel Now initiatives, which are very distinct from DC's various initiatives. There's a creative mission for each new title, and a packaging, and they are largely disconnected from each other in a way that's very different from what DiDio's describing for his major publishing push this year. I would say creatively that the Marvel Now books are largely successful. And I think it's because they are sort of, maybe you could say, in between the paradigm that Stephenson talks about and the one that DiDio is advocating, you know, sort of on the one hand, you have a purely creative model. On the other hand, you have a format that's really the main selling point. And I think Marvel is actually somewhere in the middle now that I'm saying it out loud.
Well, it's a situation where the format ties into the something conceptual or a creative team. You know what I mean? Like a number one at Marvel, and boy, have they published a lot of number ones. But a number one at Marvel means this book has new creators or it's taking a new direction. For better or worse, like some, on occasion.
Unless it's Daredevil.
Unless it's Daredevil. Well, and Daredevil is just a new place.
Yeah.
But it,
new backgrounds.
new place. Still no fear.
Yeah. Same no fear. Bold new place. But the way that, you know, sometimes those new concepts for characters haven't worked. I didn't think the new Wolverine number one worked. I felt like it was trying to put Wolverine in a box that he doesn't really need to go into. Like it was trying to force a new conceptual idea onto Wolverine the character. But in general,
well, you understood what they were trying to do. Like it made sense in a overall way. Like, now I know why they did this.
Yeah. I mean, it was a clear new direction for Wolverine. So it ties in the commerce to the creativity in a way that DC doesn't seem to necessarily be doing. It just seems to all be commerce.
Yeah, and like on that point, when Marvel starts, they do their teasers, you know, like one word teasers and stuff like that. And they're usually like all about the creative team. They're selling you the creative team. They're like, listen, guys, you saw the Avengers. You like all these characters. We're selling you the creators. It's like they don't take it for granted that people already know who Thor is, you know, and they don't have to. And it's so they really are selling you, you know, two people working on a book or three or however many. DC in this announcement, were there any creative names mentioned? You know, like, it seems like they're always selling you the concept before the creative teams. And
well,
they're not.
I think it's very telling that the third weekly title is just a weekly title.
Yeah,
that we
don't,
that we know a very little bit about the concept of, but we don't know what it's called. We don't know who's going to be working on it. We don't know which characters are going to be involved. It's just, hey, another weekly title. That ties into another thing we're doing.
A notable thing about this whole enterprise is that all of this will be going on while the company is losing staff and moving across the country. That, it seems like, fraught with portents.
Well put. Yeah, I guess the only thing I have to really add to that is you mentioned that kind of idea to me earlier, and I kind of got to thinking, and I was like, okay, I can see how that would be a total disaster, but I can also see how it would in some ways be easier, because, you know, if you think about superhero comics that are ongoing and serialized, or any kind of popular serialized entertainment, you can kind of work out, well, if this is this ongoing story and we change all these compartmentalized narratives that don't necessarily need to like bump into each other at all, if we get rid of that and just do like a smaller number of fluid stories, you can kind of stretch out your story in a way where you don't have to worry about the writing deadline so much as the art deadline. And so, you know, if you're going through all these changes as a company, in some ways it might be easier to have fewer titles that are all just one thing, instead of like 52 different titles that are all doing their own thing. So
that's,
I don't know.
Very like, interesting. I didn't think about it that way. I mean, I don't know enough about the comic book assembly line, as it were, to know for sure. But
well, I don't know if it'll work, but what I guess I'm basically saying, I'll just kind of say it raw. You know, if you have fewer things, you can just make a shittier product. You know, like you can. So the story for the year for Batman is he's going to fight the Joker and save an orphan. That you can make that take a year. You know, just add some details here and there. You know, like you can just slap it together, have this really long story where not a whole lot happens. You don't have to worry about it. So, you know, from what I know about publishing comics and putting them together, like that's way easier said than done. So, and I don't want to put it on these creators. I don't think any creators who work on these books are going to give it a half-hearted effort or anything like that. But from an editorial standpoint, if you just lock in that plot for a year, you can work with that. There's wiggle room, you know?
Well, along those same lines, you know, talking about attrition of staff or reduction of staff, if you're going from four titles that had four different editors or maybe three different editors or an editor shared two of them or whatever you want to say, if you go to one weekly title, that has one editor. That editor may be extremely overworked, and you know it probably helps to have somebody like a Scott Snyder who can be a head writer to also corral things. But there may be something to say about, you know, this move to weekly comics being a look toward an editorial staff that's going to be reduced at least temporarily.
Mm-hmm. And I guess it's worth noting that Mark Doyle from Vertigo is now the Batman group editor, and he'll presumably be overseeing all of the stuff, which is actually a very good sign that it may not, you know, everything might not be as dour or dire, rather, as Caleb suggests, with respect to Batman specifically. The other interesting thing I noticed when I was reading about these weekly comics is The Future's End is formally titled The New 52, Future's End.
Mm-hmm.
And it directly references the overall line, which we've discussed a lot, is itself a story element. It's part of a previous event, the Flashpoint crisis, if you will. So that it's actually in the title of something, and about something that sounds, you know, ominous, like Future's End. Is this yet another crisis, even another reboot?
I think that the title of Future's End is a puzzle. Like Caleb was talking about, this is one puzzle and this is another puzzle and you put them together. I think the title itself of Future's End is a puzzle because there's no apostrophe in futures. So it's plural. There's not. It's plural futures end.
Oh, so futures end, like stories end.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what that means. Whether it means there will be multiple timelines, whether it means like different futures for different characters are going to be ending.
Like DC 1 million or something like that.
I can't figure it out. But from everything I've seen in the official logo of the series, it's not future apostrophe S end, as in the end of one future. It's futures plural end.
I did not notice that. That is very important, I think, unless it's a careless mistake, in which case it's not important at all.
One other, like, I guess, train spotting detail here is that it's a red logo. And has it been presented in any other color? I haven't seen it, but it's red and yellow, and like, maybe it's just because they want like a cool graphic design, but it's kind of got like a streak through it, and then like this yellow angled zigzaggy line. So I'm like, is this a Flash thing? Is this going to go back to Flashpoint? Is like the Flash going to be at the center of this? He's getting a new TV show.
Right. Well,
all this stuff.
Every time there is a universe reboot or a multiversal event, there is a Flash in the center of it.
Yeah. So like this looks, the design is that it could point toward a Flash thing. And, it would be really interesting to see if they were going back to the old continuity or they're doing yet another reboot without collars.
Or maybe they're just going to jump the new 52 into the future and use that as a way to clean up aesthetically and structurally. Who knows? I mean, they might not even know. But
yeah, that's important to note.
It's very telling, you know. I'm not sure exactly what it tells. I don't want to be too presumptuous, but DiDio and Stephenson have both laid out in recent remarks very different philosophies about what's going to succeed in this market. And it'll be it's actually very helpful that they did so, because now we can watch very easily and see what works and what doesn't.
A couple years back, what was it? Kirkman and some other guys did their manifesto. Was that what they called it? Where they challenged all the mainstream creators to do indie books, or, you know, at least creator-owned books. And that, I think we're not just seeing, we saw the result of that, because, you know, Image, particularly in some other places, are full of creator-owned books by what we would consider mainstream creators or writers or artists. So I feel like we're living in this future that was kind of broadcast in the early to mid 2000s now. And a lot of stuff did change, and it changed for the better. When I first started doing this job, like, digital comics didn't really exist. I mean, like, they did, but you couldn't buy them, like, tons of DRM, the iPad didn't exist. Tons of stuff's changed, and we are living in, it's kind of interesting when we see these forecasts and, you know, like, I guess Eric Stephenson's mission statement, we are living in the future that we talked about 10 years ago. And now what? You know, all the Marvel movies and all the DC movies and all this stuff, it's as good as it's ever going to be. Like, you know, except for DiDio doesn't, he said things are quieting down. Stephenson's like, this is the golden age of this stuff being popular at face value. So what do we do next? And so that's kind of the question. Like, they're not going to invent digital comics again. They're here to stay. You know, like, all these things we asked for as fans and, you know, readers and whatever, 5-10 years ago, they're all here. All the movies got made. So what's next? How does comics benefit from this in the long term? And so it's going to be pretty wild to watch.
Well, you know, we've been presented two very different futures, and the question is whether those futures will end or begin, right?
That's true. It's a puzzle on another puzzle.
Will it be futures end?
Wait, whose futures end?
Futures is end.
Tune in next week to Futures End to find out whether the futures will end.
Or to see what's next.
This has been the Comics Alliance podcast. My thanks to our guest, Matt D. Wilson, whose writing and commentary you can find every day on comicsalliance.com. For more information on Matt's comic book, Copernicus Jones, Robot Detective, and his books like the Supervillain Field Manual,
visit about.me/MattDWilson. Caleb Goellner's webcomic Mermaid Evolution can be read at mermaidevolution.com, and his and Buster Moody's Task Force Rad Squad can be found at taskforceradsquad.com. The Comics Alliance editors can be reached at nowhere. If you experienced audio problems with this podcast, we do not apologize. For more Comics Alliance, please visit comicsalliance.com or follow us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and Tumblr. The username is Comics Alliance for all of them. We got it first.